I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'll stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, and he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Good morning. Good to see each of you here. What a nice sized crowd of people. What a tribute to Richard. And on behalf of the family, I want to thank each of you for coming. And we're really glad that you're here. My name is Pastor John Green, and I've been asked simply to give some direction to our time together here today. We've come together, some would say, because Dick has died. But actually, we've come together because Dick lived. And he touched lives. He touched your life. He touched it each in just a little bit different and distinctive way. It has been said that the value of any service or gathering such as this is best assessed by if the deceased was present. Would they be comfortable enough to sit through the whole thing? And that's going to be somewhat our criteria today. I want you to relax and be the person that Dick knew you to be, and enjoy this time of remembering and celebrating Dick's life. We're going to celebrate him in truth. The fact is that he, like all of us in this room, was a flesh and blood mortal. We're not here today to canonize anybody as a saint. We're here to talk respectfully, positively, but candidly about the kind of person that Dick was. So we're going to just celebrate him today, what we liked about him, how his life affected us, how just we knew him joyfully and candidly, the good memories. So be thinking about a story, some recollection, some remembrance, some happening. We could use a joke here and there, and hopefully we'll find ourselves in the midst of our sense of loss and in the sense of our grieving, we will also find ourselves smiling, at least, if not laughing, at Dick's humanity. I found a poem that I wanted to share with you because from all the reports I've been getting, I just thought that it was quite appropriate. It is titled, What is a Father? He's strength and security, laughter and fun, a prince to his daughter, a pal to his son. A great storyteller and mender of toys, who's seldom dismayed at his family's noise. He's an everyday Santa who brings home surprises, the man to consult when a problem arises. as eager a worker as they'll ever be. He wants the best for his whole family. He's a loving instructor who struggles to teach his child to achieve all the goals they can reach. And he knows in his heart that it's all worth the bother when he hears his child say, "That man, he's my father." Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the promise and the reality of your presence with us here today. We understand once again and remind ourselves that death was never your idea. And you've given us life, you've redeemed our life, and you've promised us eternal life. So thank you for all the good and perfect gifts that come from you. And today we stop for a while to remember and say thanks for Richard. Lord, we wouldn't be the humans that you made us if we didn't hurt. And we would not be the people of faith that we are if we didn't also rejoice because of the hope of life hereafter. Bless and comfort this family and help us each here today as well as in the days to come to be a means of your grace to them, to provide comfort and support. And be with us now as we spend this time honoring Richard's life. Amen. So I've been a little torn to know whether to call him Richard or whether to call him Dick. Well, how many of you knew him as Dick? So we're going to have to kind of go back and forth. I think it's mostly family that referred to him as Richard. A lot of probably work associates and people on the job who knew him as Dick. Dick Vaughn died unexpectedly. No lingering suffering for him on January 28th at the age of 78. Richard was the second oldest of five children. He was born February 27th, 1930 to Lillian and Albert Vaughn of North Bend, Oregon. Three of his siblings have predeceased him, Albert, Lillian, and Karen, who died as an infant. The church background of the family was Methodist. His family moved to the Renton area in 1939, and he continued to live and work in this area until his death. Dick attended school until he was 15 years of age, but he really wanted to fight for his country in World War II. So he lied about his age, and he enlisted, a correction that was only made on his driver's license just a couple, 3 years ago. Is that correct? I guess at some point you want to be younger, right, rather than older. As a merchant marine, he traveled up and down the Pacific coast, and then he was stationed in occupied Japan after the war ended. After serving the merchant marines in World War II, he tried several jobs until becoming a journeyman lineman, working most recently at Seattle City Light until his retirement. He married Ariel. They had two children, Christina and Danny. Things didn't work out for the couple, and their union was dissolved. Dick met Mary Lee, who lived across the street from him. They were married, and their daughter, Joy Lee, was born. Their marriage lasted 45 years. He was a very active member of Local Union 77 for 54 years. He served on many of its committees as well as its past executive board member, vice president, and president of Local 77. He volunteered much of his time to the union. Later in life, he became involved in the Governor's Safety Council. Dick finally retired at age 75. He often joked that because of his starting work at such an early age, that he had worked in one fashion or another for 65 years. He received many honors and recognitions for his work across the years. The last was just months before his death. Seattle City Light, who had been trying time after time to get him to come back to work, finally offered him a part-time job, 3 days a week, offered to him at the age of 78. Amazing, huh? So much for so many of us getting put on the shelf and forgotten. Dick loved anything with wheels. In his youth, it was cars. And later on, he developed a passion for motorcycles, to some of his children's chagrin. When riding bikes became difficult, he went back to cars. Recently, he purchased a 2-seater convertible sports car. Miata, what was it? Oh, a Crossfire? Cool. He liked to chat with folks. Nobody was a stranger. He'd visit with anyone. He was social, jovial, determined, stubborn. He had a great sense of humor. He was adventuresome, easygoing, gregarious. He was a good friend. He was a generous father. He loved football. And he liked the Seahawks when they won. He was a devoted father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and friend. He's survived by a brother, Wesley, a son, Dan, daughters, Joy, and Chris, a proud grandfather of 12 grandchildren and great-grandfather of 9 great-grandchildren. Richard loved life. He engaged it. Whether it was driving his sports car or traveling to see friends and family, he lived life to the fullest. And had he known, there would have been only one regret, and that was that just a few days ago, he missed out on IHOP's free Grand Slam. He liked going there, as many of you know. He will be greatly missed, greatly missed. At this time, there's a video tribute that the family has prepared for our viewing. And following that, we want you to share some of your stories and remembrances of Dick. We have the video now.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them that I won't be long, and they'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Yeah, we'll meet again. I don't know where, and I don't know when, but I do know that we'll meet again some sunny day. So honey, keep on smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And would you please say hello to all the folks that I know, and tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
We do want to give you that opportunity to share some of your thoughts and recollections. And what we're going to do is Dick's niece, Susan, is going to be coming around with a microphone and spotting you as you stand up because you want to say something. And she's going to have you use that microphone because it's being recorded for the video that's being made for the service today. So again, be thinking about some of the things that you'd like to tell us. Tell us who you are and your relationship to Dick, if you would. But first of all, from Dick's good friend, Charlie Brown. Dick was a true friend, my best friend for over 50 years. In the 50s, when I was on the Olympia police force and Dick was a volunteer, he'd let me drive his Austin Healey sports car to work. He didn't like it when I'd stop people and give them tickets from his car, but it was just too much fun to resist. Once we had to go to Spokane together to pick up a prisoner. We wanted very badly to go on a motorcycle ride the next day, so we drove the police car at top speed, getting there in less than 4 hours. Yeah. We didn't usually use good sense, but we sure had a lot of fun. We always rehashed that trip when we'd get together. It never lost any of the thrill, even after 50-some years. In the early 60s, I had a bad motorcycle accident. Didn't think I'd ever have that much fun in life again. A few months later, Dick rode up on his bike and said, "Grab your cane and helmet and hop on the back." And he gave me back my life that day. After Dick and Mary and Joy moved north, we didn't get to do those motorcycle rides after work and on weekends with Leo and others. Dick was a true friend. Sometimes I wouldn't see him for a couple years, and then he'd drive up unannounced out of nowhere, smiling and happy. One of those times was in the late 80s. We had a lot of people at the house after my son Todd's funeral. I'd not called Dick, but he came. He came that day. That was very special for all my family. That was Dick's way. Whenever he showed up, it was always like we'd been together just the day before, like time had stood still. It was always great to see him. He really did have that capacity to make my day. He'll always be in my thoughts and in my heart. His friend, Charlie Brown. That's great, isn't it? That's really, really so good. Well, Susan is going to facilitate our sharing time, and who would like simply to be the first, if you just stand right where you are?
I've known Richard since we were just babies. Our parents used to play pinochle. The Jack Graham family, the Vaughn family, and my family. And us kids all were in playpens, these old-fashioned wooden playpens, and we'd all sleep. They'd lay us all down and we'd all go to sleep. And when we were, well, we, of course we played a lot and we had fought a lot, but we had such a wonderful, and he's been a dear friend all these years. He just like a brother. And so all of the Vaughns have always been part of our family. And then my husband and him were dear, dear friends. They did all their young years together, and on their motorcycles, on their cars, and did all the things together that most people could never imagine those two could do, or those three could do. Yeah. But they did them, and we'll always love him very, very much, and miss him more than anybody can know. Yeah. But I thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Char Alexander, and I had the pleasure of working with Dick for about 20 years on the Governor's Advisory Board. We didn't call him Dick or Richard, we called him Pops. Hmm. The whole group at L&I became really close to him. He was a dedicated champion of worker safety and health. And everything he brought to the board was always to keep people safe and healthy. And he was just a delightful friend to everyone on the board. We're going to miss him incredibly and always think of him with affection and with love and with some laughter for all the fun he brought to our board. Thank you.
Thank you. Right in the back, Susan. I think they're doing a duet.
This is a true gentleman. There are not many of us left, I'm telling you. Two stories about Dick or Richard. My family and I got to know him initially because his daughter Joy worked for us, and through Joy we got to know her husband Fred, and once we got to know the family we got to know Dick, and he became part of our family. You saw some great pictures there of Dick cruising. Dick and I have cruised on ocean liners, and last year I had the great joy and pleasure of cruising with him on a 60-foot canal boat in the UK. And this story is not really very much in his favor, but we had talked about the differences in attitude between the British and the Americans, and how sometimes in certain parts of pubs you weren't allowed to wear a hat. Well, of course, Dick being a free-thinking American, nobody's going to tell me what I can do, what I can wear a hat. And we were sitting down to a lunch at a beautiful canalside pub, and this lovely lady walked over and asked him if he would kindly remove his cap in the lounge. It was very funny at the time.
And he complied?
He didn't reply. He just took his hat off very sheepishly and tucked into his food. And regarding the Seahawks, I can imagine him, if you said to him one day, are you going to see the Seahawks this week, Dick? He would say, well, they didn't come to see me when I was bad. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Your turn. Thank you. My name's Don Gillott. I've worked with Dick for years. Matter of fact, 23 years I've had the pleasure of working with Dick. From the looks of the collage of pictures, we can all see that Dick lived a full life. But Dick, as I've known him, he was a loving father. He was a good provider for his family, and he was a good union man. Dick was in our union for 54 years. He's been a shop steward. He's been a unit chairman. He was on the executive board. I had the pleasure of sitting on the executive board with him. He later moved on to be the president of our union, vice president of our union. He was probably a mentor to me. And I'm certainly going to miss him. In the opening, there was some statements about the possibility of sharing a story with you to, like a joke or something. But the best I can recall was one that, this was in my misspent youth, about 130 pounds ago. I used to race motorcycles, and I had an experience, and I was sharing it with Dick because Dick reminded me of this story. I was going for a race in Waco, Texas, and I had a 1953 Chevrolet pickup truck. The speedometer didn't work, but the right front fender would start shaking at about 50 or 55. I take this farm-to market road into Waco. Now, this was a road that there was no traffic on. You could see the curvature of the earth. And I didn't know if I had enough gas. I didn't know if I was going to have to unload my motorcycle to ride it into Waco to get fuel. But I did notice on the side of the road a farmhouse. And this is where Dick Vaughn comes in. There was a farmer on the front porch in his chair. I stopped and didn't pull off the road because there was no traffic. But I stopped and stood on the running boards and asked the gentleman on the porch, which Dick Vaughn reminds me of, is this the road to Waco? And he said, yes, it is. And I said, well, how far is it? And he said, what do you care? You're going there anyway. That was the Dick I knew. And I'm certainly going to miss Dick. I did notice one thing in the collage of pictures. There was a Ford pickup truck pulling a fifth wheel. I now own that truck, and it's running very strong. I wanted to tell the family that. So yeah. That's all I've got to say.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Oh, one other thing. I'm sorry I was remiss in saying this. Lou Walters, which is also a dear friend of Dick's. Lou was called this morning. He's a rep that works for Local 77. He's going through a termination hearing, and I'm sure Dick would understand the reason that Dick's not, that Joe, sorry, Lou is not here, because he's trying to defend one of our union members. And also Stan Jacobs, which is a longtime friend of Dick's, is in Florida and is retired and was unable, but he did want me to mention some good things for him. So thank you guys.
I can't help myself sometimes. My name's Leo Rancor, and try to keep it together here a little bit. I met Dick. I was riding a motorcycle. I was 17. I'm 65 now. But I can remember we would, Dick and Charlie and me and several other folks were on bike rides, and we'd pull into a town, and remember this was in the early 60s, and we'd pull into a small town, usually on some kind of like a Memorial Day weekend or something like that, and we'd usually pick up a couple squad cars pulling into town, because they, you know, the Hells Angels were really vibrant about that time, and we might have resembled them a bit because they're all riding Harleys. And it was a little hard on the local department because we always all pull up to the police department, pull up in front and park out front. And what was on their mind was that we were going to ransack the local department and leave them in shambles. But actually what we were doing is I was on the reserve department, Olympia too, and we would have to check in. Because being a, you know, like Labor Day or Memorial Day weekend, we'd have to check in case they needed us or go back to Olympia and fight the bad guys. So we spent a lot of time on the bikes together, and it was, you know, a lot of fun. And Dick used to go with us on our boat of just recent, within the last year, actually 2 years. And so we had a lot of fun going up to San Juan's and he would sometimes in rough weather hold stuff down while Bonnie sat on the floor worried whether we were going to make it back or not. So a lot of that stuff went on with Dick, and actually he was always known as RL around our house. So it last few years is a Tuesday occurrence that he'd come down and have coffee with us.
Thank you.
I'm Henry Brooks. I met Dick in 1960, and I had a garage on Martin Way in Olympia. Dick lived across the street from me and where I worked, and this little gal and that one was just about like this, and that one wasn't even here yet. She scared me to death when he handed her to me. And you just can't believe some of the stories on Charlie Brown and him and that Austin Healey. That was his hot rod.
Don't you just love stories about people who just knew how to have fun in life, risk a little bit, have some adventures, stay about three steps ahead of the law in the process? They knew how to do it well. Anybody else?
Yes. Hi, I'm Art Locken. I've known Dick for probably 30 years, and he got me involved in the union when he was the union president, and got me going on, put me on a lot of committees and did a lot of things with me. But the story I'm going to tell is one where we went to New Orleans together. It was Dick, my wife, and myself, and we were down there. And so I took Dick into a restaurant. I said, I'm going to take you in and buy you dinner tonight. And it was, and I knew what it was. It was called P.F. Chang's, and it had transvestite waitresses. And so I bought Dick 3 whiskeys, kept feeding him whiskey, and I go, "What'd you think of that one, Dick?" I didn't tell him now. I says, "What'd you think of that gal?" Finally turned around after his 3rd whiskey and said, "What do you think, I'm stupid? I know they're a goddamn man." But I thought about that story on the way here, and I always, yeah. Dick and me were close, and, you know, I just sat with him just last month, me and him had lunch out at the governor's board, and I got to be the guy that took his place on the board, and I'll surely miss him, and thanks for having us here.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm Tasha Stillman, and all of us had the pleasure of being Dick's neighbor for the last several years. And I probably have many, many stories. But one particularly comes to mind is the one rare time we had no power. And that didn't happen very often when Dick was your neighbor. But it was about 4 or 5 years ago in February when we had that huge storm. I don't know if everybody remembers that. And we lost power. And all of us are trying to get our generators going. Of course, Dick had his going right away. And I look outside and I see Dick walking up and down the street, and I'm like, what is he doing? So then about 10 minutes later, I look out again and he's got his belt on. And I go to Kevin, I'm like, what is he doing? What is he doing? So I go, what are you doing? And he's like, well, I found out where we lost power. I'm just gonna go climb that pole. So I'm telling the guys, I said, you know, we gotta go get him because he's gonna climb the pole and give us power back. So the guys go out there and Dick tells him, well, you know what? Why don't you young men just get up that pole and climb it? So we went round and round with Dick for about 20 minutes and got him to not go up the pole. So then we convinced him that, you know, we would call or he could call. And so he's like, no, I'll just handle it. So about all that night, we had power back because Dick got on the phone, called somebody, told him where to go, told him where the power was out. And that was one of the rare, rare cases that we had no power for like a brief 2 hours with Dick.
Hi, I'm Bill Challenger. I worked with Dick at Seattle City Light, and I didn't know him until he came there. And in conversation one day, I was talking to him, and he found out that an uncle I had was someone that he had worked with, and that uncle had passed away, and it was sometime in the 90s, and Dick took the time to attend the funeral, and it meant a lot to the family, and that was kind of fellow that I remember Dick as. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Hi, my name's Jeff Vaughn. I'm Richard's nephew. He loved his family, all of us, and the story I want to tell is how I got into the union. I'm also one of the 77. And he called me one day and he said, Jeff, he says, you want a job? And I said, well, I've got a job. Well, what do you need? And he says, I need an operator. He says, well, I don't know how to operate. You know, I can't, you know, run anything. He says, I know you. He says, you're going to make a good operator. I said, well, no, thank you. I didn't want to take a job from my uncle to get into the union. Well, a year later, he calls me again. He says, Jeff, this is your last chance. He says, you want a union? He says, I got a job for you. I can get you in. You can become an operator. Well, after a year, I said, yeah, they do it for me. Well, I've been in the trade now for about 32 years, and I'm still an operator. But I, you know, between operators and journeyman linemen, I'd just soon be an operator as a lineman. No offense to those linemen, if there's any out there. But he always knew where I was. He always knew if I got in trouble. He always knew if I got hurt. He always knew everything. So I talked to him, I said, how do you know? And he says, I'm the president of the union. You don't think I don't know where you're at? You know, what you're doing, what kind of trouble you're getting into? But it was just always amazed that Howie, you know, always kept track of where I was and did, you know. But And I'll always be forever in his debt for getting me into the union, pushing me in there, because you know, I make a pretty good living now, and I owe it all to him. Hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. These are great stories.
I will always, I'm Lorianne Vaughn, Dan Vaughn's, or Richard Vaughn's daughter-in-law. I'll always remember when Richard would call and he would say, "Hey, kid," every single time. He would just say, "Hey, kid," I will miss that. He would joke about how stubborn his son was being, and we would banter back and forth about the little mishaps going on. But what he really instilled, I think, in all three of his children, Joy and Chris and Dan, was a sense of responsibility for him, for themselves and their families. And I just see it so prevalent in all of your families. Joy and Chris, your families are wonderful, and I think he was a wonderful mentor.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, let's just try something right where you are. This may get on the tape, it may not, but no speeches at this point, but just around the room, one-word descriptions of Dick.
A wonderful friend.
Great.
Fun.
All the time.
Fun all the time. Anyone else?
Character.
A character.
There's some.
Interesting.
Proud.
Proud. Yeah. Cool. Somebody else said something.
Loyal. He's very loyal.
Wow. Yeah. What traits? What traits? A couple more?
Lineman.
One time?
Lineman. Journeyman lineman.
Proud. Yeah. One other?
Volunteer.
A volunteer.
Consistent.
Gosh. Pardon me, sir?
Referee?
Stand in the middle, opposing parties?
Yeah.
Some people know, don't they? These are great traits. Great traits. Dick, Richard, belonged to what Tom Brokaw called in his book, The Greatest Generation. It's a lot of noble things about those folk, that generation, and many of them have been noted today. I think that so very often in terms of a message at a funeral service, that often, and in this case it is true, that the man is the message. There's plenty enough to meditate on here. There's plenty enough to use for an example. There's plenty enough to serve as an inspiration. Some of the things that you shared in your stories bespeak of a character, a depth of character, an understanding, an empathy, a friendship. Some of the things that you noted in your one-word descriptions point to the nobility of Dick. It's been good to gather and to remember. And that's what these times are about primarily. They are mostly about remembering and celebrating and giving thanks, if you will. The Jews have a statement. They say that the truly dead are simply those who are never remembered, who are not remembered. Civilizations, countries, nations will be known, yes, for their human rights records, how they treat people while they're alive. But they will also be remembered in the annals of history by how they memorialize those who departed from them. I have a feeling that Dick is going to be remembered for a very, very long time in your hearts and in your minds. So today the message is the man. There's a second thing that happens that might not seem quite so obvious on the surface, but it does happen when we gather like this. This is its own kind of time out for all of us. A kind of intervention to varying degrees for each of our consciousness, The fact is that something about our own mortality, one more layer of it is exposed. We know that for each of us, there'll be a similar gathering someday. We will each one pass this way. This is a moment unlike so many other moments in which we are engaged in life, having the adventures, seeking our goals. It's a time of sort of heightened consciousness about life. When we remember what's really important, that it is not like so many of the influences that we each one are bombarded with. It's not about position or possession. It's about relationship. It's about character. It's about virtue. It's about personal dignity. It's about all of those sorts of things. We're reminded in times like this that the quality of life is not what we get, but what we give. And somebody has suggested that you really spell love, G-I-V-E. It means to give. We don't always get in life what we want, but today is living proof that we always get who we are. We always get who we are. That life is not about duration or number of years, but rather about donation. Mother Teresa, that little Roman Catholic nun who gave herself away in Bombay to disenfranchised poor people who had no other means of support and were ailing, rose to speak at the invitation of the United Nations one day, and among the things that she said was, "Whatever is not given is wasted." All good words for us to attach ourselves to today. So life is really not about the stuff. The stuff is really character, core values, spirituality, all the very intangible but real kinds of things. And on the marker that marks the grave out in the cemetery, when we distill the life down into just a few characters chiseled into some granite, there'll be the name, there'll be the dates, there'll be maybe some graphic to bespeak of a hobby like motorcycling. There'll be a term of endearment, loving father. And the smallest and what would appear to be the most insignificant of all the etchings on that stone is this one little dash that appears its only purpose is to separate the date of birth from the date of death. And yet probably that one little short continuum is the most important symbolism of all, because it bespeaks of the life lived. It's where you and I are right now. We're chiseling that dash. It's not yet complete. This is where we live and love and learn and laugh. And I guess, you know, Dick's passing raises for us once again the question of how shall we now live? I was wondering what happened to that great theologian the other day, Irma Bombeck. I lost track. I just didn't know what happened to her. And I understand that a few years back, not that many years back, she's diagnosed with cancer and she died. And at that moment of realization, she wrote something that she called, If I Had It to Do Over Again. And she said some rather profound things. Among them was, if I had it to do again, I'd say, I love you more. I don't know about you, but I've said lots of things that I've regretted. Things I wish I could take back and have gone back and made my apologies and begged for forgiveness. And yet that stuff is still a matter of record, right? It's still there. But there, of the things that I've not said too much, probably the top of the list is, I love you. You just can't say it too much. You just can't assume that, you know, well, you know I love you. No, don't do that. Tell somebody today, maybe several somebodies, maybe before you get out of this room. I love you. I love you. The second thing that she said was, I'd say, I'm sorry more often. There's all these little disconnects between us. It's just part of the human struggle. It's because of things that are of principle and some things that we don't even know what they're about anymore. And they separate. Irma Bombeck said, if I had it to do again, I would say, I'm sorry, more often. You know, some of the prevailing wisdom is that love is never having to say you're sorry, and we know that's wrong. We know that's wrong. It's a way to break down some of the barrier and reconnect and have a relationship with somebody that we really want to have a relationship with. And the last thing was, she said, be at peace in your spirit. You know, if you're an evangelical, you could say, you know, be at peace with God, have accepted Christ, and, you know, whatever the language is that you prefer. The main thing is that principle of being at peace in your spirit, that there's a calm, that there's a readiness, that everything is okay, that accounts are settled. Maybe it's best illustrated by the story of St. Francis of Assisi. One day somebody said, St. Francis, if you knew that in 5 minutes your life would be required of you, what would you do? Well, he happened to be in his garden and he was hoeing a row of beans. And, you know, if that question had been put to me at different junctures in my life or in your life, we can think of 100 things we'd hurry to get done. To settle accounts, to make it right, to restore relationships, all kinds of stuff. You know, some of the guilt we've carried and some of the regret that we've carried. And St. Francis didn't miss a beat. He said to the one inquiring, if I had 5 minutes yet to live, I simply would finish hoeing this row of beans. What a nice place to be. Everything's up to date, accounts are settled, relationships are good. I'm ready. I'm not fearful. I'm just ready. So today, an exhortation to you from a pastor. Live like people who are prepared to die, and die like people who are prepared to live. Let's pray. God, this has been refreshing today. This has been good. This has been fun. And thank you for this life so uniquely lived among us, for the generosity of it, for the grace of it, for the nobility of it, for the humanness of it. And we will be forever impacted by Dick's life and all of those good qualities that showed through him. We count as that part of the image of God that was shining through. Those are your attributes. So help us to live in that way. And thank you again for Dick and for the inspiration of his life. And again, we pray that you'd be with his family. In your name. And now may the love and grace of God, our Father, the peace of his Son, our elder brother, and the abiding, comforting, guiding presence of the Spirit be with us all, now and forever. And all the people said,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
I am a lineman for the county, and I drive the main road, searching in the sun for another overload. I hear you singing in the wire, I can hear you through the whine. And the Wichita lineman is is still on the line. I know I need a small vacation, but it don't look like rain. And if it snows, that stretch down south won't ever stand the strain. And I need you more than want you, and I want you for all time. And the Wichita lineman is still on the line.
Well, I think I'm with the right group today for the most part. Most of you will recognize the name of Winston Churchill. Oh, yes. There's a story told about Winston Churchill that he had done his own funeral pre-planning in terms of the service. He laid out every single last specific in terms of what was to take place at the cathedral at his service. I mean, he had it right down to the smallest item. What choirs were supposed to sing, what titles they were supposed to sing, what the organ played, who was the organist, who the dignitaries were from around the world who should share, right on down to the last detail. So the service progressed, it came to its conclusion, and unbeknownst to so many people, at the very, very close, when the postlude, the organ postlude notes began to just sort of fade out, and everybody thought that was the end of the service, and they started to rustle as if to exit, unbeknownst to almost everybody, there was a lone bugler who played. And he played taps. And that's always stirring. It's always touching. It just triggers something. The words of that tune are, day is done. Day is done. It signals the end of conflict. It signals the end of the engagement. It tells of a time of repose. It signals the fact that some are wounded, many are tired, and many are dead. It's a point of termination. Taps. Day is done. Folks thought it was a fitting close. And the strains of that bugle began to play out. And people moved in tears, began once more to rustle, to get ready to leave. And lo and behold, another bugler played. What do you think that one played? Reveille. You know the words to that? It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning. And he embodied a really, really important piece of Christian theology at that point. It's about the fact that life does, on this plane, end. And we return to the earth what belongs and came from the earth. But the Spirit goes on and it returns to the one who gave them life. It's about resurrection. It's about new life. It's about eternal glory, and it includes reunion. That's the promise of Christian faith, is that there's going to be a reunion, and that this isn't all there is. This isn't the whole story. Let's pray. Eternal God, our Father, from whom we come and to whom we go, grant us the favor of your divine presence at this time in our earthly pilgrimage. Assure us by your Spirit that the one we serve, he has conquered death and is alive forevermore. Help us to enable us to see our temporal lives in the light of the eternal. And so may our spirits grow calm and our vision clear. In the name of the Lord, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
and I need you more than want you. And I want you for all time. And the Wichita lineman is still on the line.